So in the decomposition of the elliptic genus of K3, we encountered an object which I said was a Mach modular form. And I should define what that is. Now, there's a very interesting and colorful history, which I'm not going to tell you about, but you can read about in various places. These objects were invented by Ramanujan in the last year of his life and described in a letter that he wrote to Hardy. But he didn't define them. He just wrote down examples. And it took mathematicians a long time to figure out what he was doing and a more rigorous mathematical framework for them. And I'll be telling you about the results of some of that investigation. Although I've talked to mathematicians who claim that the correct definition is not yet understood, that there should be something better. But anyway, I can tell you what there is. So let me just, I think earlier on I should have defined a modular form. I kind of assumed it was something that you knew, but just to make sure that we both, that we're all on the same page, a modular form of white K is a holomorphic function from the upper half plane, the complex numbers, which obeys this modular transformation property. And we sometimes weaken this or vary this in various ways. So we sometimes talk about weakly holomorphic modular forms. That means that when we look at f of tau, and write a Q expansion for it, we allow some negative powers of Q. So we might have a sum here that starts at n greater than some minus n. These are called weakly holomorphic. And the other thing that we can do here is we could insert some rho here, which is either a phase, or if we want to look at, it could be a matrix if we're looking at vector-valued modular forms. A matrix meaning that we have some, matrix that depends on an element of SL2Z, gives us some representation of that, which mixes the components of F. So these are natural generalizations that occur in conformal field theory. All right, so what is a Mach modular form? Well, there are various ways to define it, but here's one way. You start with an object which is kind of like a modular form, but different. You start with something that's called a weight K harmonic mass form. I'm not sure if it's mass or mass, but anyway, it's M-A-A-S-S, which is the name of a mathematician. And a weight K harmonic mass form is a function, not necessarily holomorphic, from the upper half plane to the complex numbers, such that it transforms under modular transformations like a modular form. Perhaps with some phase, some multiplier system, or you could consider vector value generalizations, but I won't worry about those subtleties right now. And it obeys the equation that the weight K Laplacian, y to the 2 minus k d by d tau, y to the k d by d tau bar, is equal to 0 on F. So here the weight K Laplacian is just the Laplacian acting on K forms on the upper half plane. we write tau as x plus iy, then we use the usual metric that has constant negative curvature on the upper half plane, and delta k is the associated weight k Laplacian. So you could think of this as, suppose you were doing quantum mechanics, but instead of doing quantum mechanics on the line or the plane with the flat metric, you were doing quantum mechanics on the upper half plane. If you're doing quantum mechanics on the upper half plane and you didn't have a potential, then the eigenfunctions would be solutions to the Laplacian, and these would be like zero energy states in quantum mechanics. So that's kind of, you know, you could think of them sort of like that. So the mass form means it's an eigenvalue of the weight k Laplacian. The weight k means it transforms like a weight k modular form, and harmonic means that it has eigenvalue zero under the weight k Laplacian. I'll let mk hat denote the space of weight k harmonic mass forms. So now we also consider the space MK with a little bang there, which is the space of weakly holomorphic weight K modular forms. All right, so now what we're going to do is, given one of these weight k harmonic mass forms, I haven't told you how to find them yet, but if we have one of these things, we're going to construct a Mach modular form. So what we do is, if we have one of these harmonic mass forms, we define a map called the shadow map by S of F hat is equal Y to the K D F hat by D tau bar, and then we take the complex conjugate of that quantity. Yeah. A K-form. All right, so now let's notice that if F hat happens to be a weight K modular form, weakly holomorphic, then S on this gives zero, because if F hat is weakly holomorphic, then D by D tau bar of it vanishes, and so the shadow map kills it. And if, as true in the examples related to moonshine that I'll discuss, the image of this shadow map vanishes as we go off to I infinity, then you can invert the shadow map. Very explicitly, so in other words, if you have some Oh, I forgot to mention something over here. It follows from the fact that f hat obeys is annihilated by the weight-k-Laplacian, and this formula that s of f hat is actually a weight 2 minus k modular form. So the fact that this is holomorphic follows from the fact that it's annihilated by this weight-k modular form, because this part of it is basically just the shadow map up to a complex conjugation. And using the transformation properties of this derivative in y to the k, you can check that this has weight 2 minus k if f hat has weight k. So this produces a weight 2 minus k modular form. And if you have one of these harmonic mass forms, then you can invert the shadow map by doing an integral. And there's a proportionality constant here, which I won't worry about. And there's some annoying business here, which has to do with the fact that you complex conjugate here. You could reformulate everything without doing this, but then you would get modular forms that were anti-holomorphic, which are not sort of as natural. I mean, they're perfectly natural, but they're not what mathematicians are used to. So because of this complex conjugation, there's some funny business here where you have to complex conjugate the argument, put a minus sign, and then complex conjugate the whole thing. But if you simply act on this integral with the shadow map, you will see that you get g back if you choose the proportionality constant correctly. And so this inverts the map. That is, if you have a g star here, the shadow map gives you g. You can invert this to extract g star in terms of g. Weakly holomorphic means you're allowed to have a finite number of terms that have negative powers of q. All right, so it takes a few lines of computation, but you can check using the statements that I've given you that you now have the following nice situation. If you have one of these weak harmonic mass forms, and the shadow map gives you a G, which is weight 2 minus K modular form, then the difference between F hat and G star is holomorphic. Because if I take d by d tau bar on it up to a factor of y to the k, that's just the shadow map. And from this, these two terms cancel out. So this is holomorphic. F hat is f plus g star. And this is modular, meaning it transforms like a weight k modular form. But it is not holomorphic unless g is equal to 0. F is holomorphic, but it's not modular. So this is a situation that's kind of like the holomorphic anomaly in supersymmetric gauge theories. There's a tension between two things you would like to be true. We're used to dealing with holomorphic functions, and that often arises as a condition of supersymmetry or, you know, in modular forms because we, like in the elliptic genus, we've canceled out the Q-bar dependence by having some ground state condition. And you would like things to be modular, but in this situation, you can't have both. You either have something that's holomorphic and not modular, or modular but not holomorphic, whenever this shadow, G, is non-zero. Yeah, I mean, this is an inverse, but it's not a unique inverse. So, yeah. No, it's 2 minus k. Thanks. Okay, so the pair F and G is called a Mach modular form. And its shadow. And F hat is called the completion of F. So in this description, F is sort of the holomorphic part of a harmonic mass form. So this gives you kind of an abstract definition, and you could then say, well, all right, how do you actually construct these things? What are examples of them? Well, so the first example is that a modular form is a Mach modular form with zero shadow. And so, okay, good. So it's a generalization of the notion of a modular form. If the shadow is zero, then there's no problem. It's, you know, you have something that's already holomorphic. Now, this is not entirely trivial. So, for example, J of tau that showed up in Monstrous Moonshine is a weight zero modular form. You might ask yourself, why couldn't we have had a Mach modular form? I mean, could it be some kind of moonshine where there's a Mach modular form? Well, because the upper half plane mod SL2Z is genus zero, it tells us that there are no weight two modular forms. If there were weight two modular forms, they could be the shadow of something that's weight zero, and there could be weight zero Mach modular forms. But because the space of weight two modular forms vanishes, J has to be modular. So this kind of reasoning can be extended in other situations where the genus zero property is kind of connected to modularity or Mach modularity. When the space of some forms that could be shadows vanishes, then you are sort of forced to land on modular forms. Now, a second example, which is slightly less trivial, but not too much less trivial, is to look at Eisenstein series. So it's a famous fact that when 2k is even and k is greater than 1, this defines a weight 2k modular form. And on the other hand, G2 is not convergent, or not absolutely convergent. And showing that it's a modular form involves rearranging terms in the sum, which you're not allowed to do if it's not absolutely convergent. So it's a fairly famous fact that you can choose a particular way of ordering this series, where you now define G2 be the sum over n squared plus a sum m not equal to 0, sum on n 1 over m tau plus n squared. And this quantity g2 hat transforms like a weight to modular form, but it's not holomorphic because of this term involving the 1 over m tau. And so g2 hat is a Mach modular form with constant shadow. So that's a definition, and it would now be nice to discuss in detail how to construct other examples, but I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to tell you that you can show that this quantity H2 of tau, which exhibits this connection to M24, which is still somewhat mysterious, is a weight 1/2 Mach modular form, shadow 24 times eta cubed of tau. Notice that this is weight 3/2. So this is indeed an example where this guy is weight 1/2. This is weight 2 minus k. 2 minus 1/2 is 3/2. And you can also show that when you look at this Mackay-Thompson series, that the twisted versions are also Mach modular forms. And you do that by showing that for each G in M24 and with chi of G being the character of G in, well, M24 has a 23-dimensional representation and a 1-dimensional representation, so there's a 24-dimensional reducible representation. Let chi of G be the character of G in that representation, then you can show that these twisted versions are given by chi of G over 24 times H2 of tau minus Tg of tau, where Tg of tau is a weight to modular form for gamma naught of n. And in the simplest cases, n is the order of g. In slightly more complicated cases, it's something a little more complicated than that. But this part is modular. This part is Mach modular because H2 is Mach modular, unless chi of g is equal to 0. And chi of g is equal to 0 for some classes. And then H2 of g is actually modular and not Mach modular. So the papers that I described earlier, who looked at the twined versions of this, showed that there is a decomposition of these terms into representations, which preserves the Mach modularity in this sense that the twined guys are still Mach modular forms when chi of g is non-zero. They're modular when chi of g is 0 by explicitly constructing these Tg of taus for all conjugacy classes of the monster. So that's the question that you asked earlier. Yeah, there is a characterization in terms of I think in terms of their decomposition with respect to M23 or something like that, but I forget exactly what the statement is. All right, so you can see that the moonshine story here is more obscure because we don't have an explicit conformal field theory exhibiting the symmetry. It's mathematically more complicated because it involves these Mach modular forms rather than modular forms. And while you can manipulate them sort of like modular forms now, they're a little more complicated to deal with. And so the question is, can we somehow use this mathematical formulation or something involving K3 to understand what's going on? And in trying to do that, it's natural to either think like a physicist or to think like a mathematician. Right? No, I mean, there is no genus zero. These guys are weight. These guys are not weight zero. They're weight. They're weight two. So, no. If you set g equal identity, this vanishes, and chi of g is 24 because it's a 24-dimensional representation. You're just looking at the character of the identity, and you just recover H2. There is a genus zero property here, but to describe it, I think I need to discuss the extension to umbral moonshine because it's a little more visible in that broader context. So, maybe by physicist here, what I really mean is string theorist. So, go ahead.
So it's sort of a vague question, but what the definition of your twined character?
Yeah. Not really, because when you look at this, when you look at H2, all right, I'm just making something up. I didn't actually remember that. These guys, you look at them and you go, all right, there's a 45-dimensional irrep, there's a 231, there's a 770. It's sort of obvious what to do. But But when you get to something like this, it's not obvious what to do. There are a finite number of irreducible representations, and you can probably write this number as a sum of irreducible representations with positive coefficients in, you know, 35 different ways. Which way are you supposed to write it? You don't know. And each way of writing it will give you a different twined guy. So you can't predict in advance what you're going to get. All you can do is you can look at the first so many terms, you can try to match it with something that has Mach modular properties, and then you can use that to predict what the higher order terms should be in terms of the higher order terms in that Q expansion. Right.
Any Hilbert space.
Right.
Isn't just that enough to tell you?
No, in general, you won't get something that's modular at all. I mean, suppose I looked at J of tau, and instead of 196883, you know, being that representation of the monster, it was 196883 times the identity, but I used some other decomposition for higher guys. You know, when you twined it, you would just get something that was not modular at all. But it didn't come from a torus partition function. It came from taking the elliptic genus and doing this weird decomposition, throwing away the massless characters, keeping the massive. Well, I agree. If you can identify a Hilbert space of states that these numbers are counting positive multiplicities, and that is connected with the conformal field theory, then yes. But we don't have that. But the partition function should be weight zero. This is weight a half. And it's not even modular, it's Mach modular. So I really don't know how to answer your question.
Why isn't that an inconsistency?
What? Why isn't what an inconsistency?
It's got a funny.
I don't understand. Go ahead.
The question was, suppose you had a Hilbert, as suppose there was some conformal field theory.
Right. Yes, yeah, if I had such a situation. So, exactly. So if I had a conformal field theory and I'm computing an insertion of G, this looks like this. Now, we know that when we take if we do modular transformations, this goes to some G to some power, and I can ask what transformations leave that fixed. And I believe the answer is that if you look at gamma naught of n, where n is the order of g, then g1 goes to g1. And so that this should be a modular form for gamma naught of n, if we had a conformal field theory. And we had the partition function of it. But we don't. We don't. So we can't conclude. I mean, it's not modular, it's Mach modular. It's true that there are these H2 of G's, and even worse, there are H2s of G's and H, where H and G are commuting pairs of elements in M24 that you can define, just like you'd expect to be able to define twisted and twined guys in a conformal field theory. But the construction of these is all purely through manipulating Mach modular forms and not through CFT constructions, which is why it suggests that there's some CFT way of understanding it, but nobody knows what that is yet. So, I mean, I'm sympathetic to the desire you're expressing, but I don't. So, all right, so I still have half an hour, right? Is that right? What time did I start? Yeah, okay. 25 minutes. Okay. Well, I can't possibly say that much, but I think the most natural thing to think is, since we found evidence for M24 in the elliptic genus of K3, we should look at the elliptic genus for X being some other Calabi-Yau manifolds. And it might actually be more natural to look at, two N-folds, so things that have some hyperkähler structure, so that we have an N equals 4. But as far as I know, that doesn't seem to lead to interesting generalizations where you find evidence for some other kind of group. But if you think more just mathematically, you could ask, can we generalize the quantity phi 0 1, which appears in the elliptic genus of K3, and not worry whether this generalization is connected to the elliptic genus of something, but just whether mathematically it gives something that generalizes this construction. And the answer is yes. And so this is work done with Randa Cheng and John Duncan, and inspired by and following some results by Atish, Samir Murthy, and Don Zage. You can find the following structure, which was found somewhat experimentally, and then once we sort of recognized the pattern, you could see how everything fit together. So for each x, which is the root lattice of a Niemeyer lattice that I discussed in the first lecture, so there are 23 of these. For each one, you can construct a whole bevy of mathematical objects. So first of all, you can construct LX, which is the Niemeyer lattice. To do this, you have to add in various weights in the weight lattice of corresponding to the root lattice, but there's a way of doing that. You can construct a pair HX and SX, which are vector valued Mach modular form and its shadow with M of X minus 1 components, where M of X is the Coxeter number of X. These exhibit moonshine in the same way that H2 did for M24 for a group GX, which is the automorphism group of the Niemeyer lattice divided by the Weil group of X generated by reflections in the roots. And for X equals A1 to the 24th, Gx is M24. For X equals A2 to the 12th, which is another one of the root systems for Niemeyer lattice, Gx has a normal subgroup, and quotienting by that gives another Mathieu group, M12. if x is equal to E8 cubed, gx is just the permutation group on three objects because you just permute the three copies of E8. So you get sporadic groups, extensions of sporadic groups. Sometimes you get rather small groups in this pattern. And you can also construct gamma x and tx, which is a genus zero subgroup of SL2Z and its help module. So here, the genus zero characterization is not so much in these Mackay-Thompson series, but it's like each example that has a Mach modular form and a group exhibiting moonshine for it is associated to a particular genus zero subgroup. And I haven't told you how to construct these yet, but they can be constructed from essentially the eigenvalues of the Coxeter element in terms of a ratio of eta functions. Now, I want to say just a few, I guess, what do I want to say? It doesn't particularly. It's just you can do it. So I want to say a couple more things about the nature of this construction, then I want to make some general comments. So to construct HX, you can use the same idea that we did in the elliptic genus. But you have to choose certain special weight 0 and index m minus 1 Jacobi forms into n equals 4 characters. And these n equals 4 characters are labeled as before, but now L goes from a half up to M minus 1 over 2. So you get vector-valued guys where R can go from 1 up to M minus 1. And I'll just give you a couple of examples of what these Jacobi forms are. So if Fi equal to theta I of tau and z over theta I of tau for I equals 2, 3, and 4, then we saw that the elliptic genus of K3, after being corrected for a stupid mistake, was F2 squared plus F3 squared plus F4 squared. It turns out that this is the guy associated A1 to the 24. For A2 to the 12th, the corresponding form has weight 0 and index 2 and is given by 4 F2 squared, F3 squared, plus F3 squared, F4 squared, plus F4 squared, F2 squared. And for A3 to the 8th, this. And these all are chosen such that there is a condition that tells you sort of what kind of negative powers of Q are allowed. And they tell you that Q to the 1 over 4m times hrx is always order 1. So you're never allowed to have anything more singular than Q to the minus 1 over 4m. And that strongly restricts the forms that are allowed here. And it can be viewed as really a growth condition on the coefficients of the Jacobi form, a growth condition which was in the DMZ paper. So there are a lot of details here, but I want to try to say something before I have to quit about what the general issues are and what how people are trying to address them. So one of the main problems in trying to understand what's going on is that the construction of the Mach modular forms, HX, or the Jacobi forms that they're built from, is not really connected to the construction of the group. But somehow, nonetheless, you can check that they exhibit moonshine for GX by explicitly constructing the twined guys and verifying their Mach modularity. So in other words, this group is determined by a Niemeyer lattice. The coefficients of these Mach modular forms have nice decompositions into representations of that group. You can twine, you can get things that are Mach modular, but it's not clear why this group is acting. It's just completely obscure. So it's natural to try to find a connection between them. So one of the central problems is how do we connect the root system X or the Niemeyer lattice LX to the group. There's a mysterious connection. So if you try to think about this from the point of view of conformal field theory, you ask yourself, well, X has an ADE classification. It's given by ADE components with total rank 24 and equal Coxeter number. H of X is a Mach modular form. Is there some framework that we know in conformal field theory that has an ADE classification and that involves Mach modular forms? And Mach modular forms occur, or things closely related to them, occur as the elliptic genus in non-compact conformal field theories. The most famous example, which has been well studied, is the cigar conformal field theory, where you take SL2R mod U1. And the elliptic genus of this theory was investigated by Troost and Ashok and Iguchi and Sugawara. And what happens in a non-compact theory like this is you have the usual discrete states of a compact conformal field theory, but then at some point a continuum of scattering states comes in, just like in quantum mechanics problems where you have both bound states and scattering states. And for the discrete states, you will get a contribution to the elliptic genus, which is holomorphic by the usual argument, but it's not modular because it doesn't include the full spectrum of the theory, and if you don't sum over the full spectrum, you don't expect to get something modular. If you compute the elliptic genus with the full spectrum, you get an Z elliptic, which is modular, but it's not holomorphic because in a supersymmetric theory, while supersymmetry pairs energies, bosons and fermions with the same energy, it doesn't require that you have the same spectral densities of fermions and bosons. And that difference in the spectral density, when you integrate over the continuum, ends up giving you a contribution to the elliptic genus, which is not holomorphic. So you have this exactly the same tension that occurs in Mach modular forms. And so it's natural to look for a non-compact conformal field theory that has some kind of ADE classification. And we know examples of that. They have dual descriptions. And you can either think of a theory where you take five brains, which have an ADE classification, which is the ADE classification of the 2-0 theory, and you can wrap them on K3, or you could look at C2 mod G for G, a discrete subgroup of SU2, which is a local model for the kind of singularities that you can have in a K3 surface, which have an ADE classification. And you could use the Mackay correspondence between cyclic groups, dihedral subgroups, the orthogonal tetrahedral group, orthogonal octahedral group, and the icosahedral group, and AN, DN, or D2N, E6, E7, and E8. And these kinds of theories have been investigated by Samir Murthy and I, Nazaroglu, Cheng and Harrison, and recently by Iguchi and Sugawara. And you get results that are suggestive, but so far not sort of on the nose. You can get things that have Mach modular properties, you can get various groups acting, but you don't so far get the umbral groups on the nose acting on the Mach modular forms of umbral moonshine. So it may be that something along these lines works and it just has to be more refined, or it could be that this is sort of barking up the wrong tree and there's some other modification. There also seem to be connections to three-dimensional gravity, which I don't think have time to explore or to discuss. But basically, there's a really interesting unsolved problem. There's a rich mathematical structure which generalizes the connection between K3 and M24. It involves Mach modular forms, special groups, Niemeyer lattices, things that often occur in string theory. But no one has figured out how to put all the ingredients together to really explain what's going on. And I think if we figure out how to do that, we'll probably learn something interesting about string theory, maybe some new kind of construction, in the same way that monstrous moonshine really used an asymmetric orbifold construction before physicists knew what asymmetric orbifolds were. And if we'd really understood that deeply, we would have seen that there were interesting generalizations. So my hope is that we'll learn something interesting about 3D gravity or black holes or new constructions in conformal field theory if we really figure out what's going on here. And I'm sorry that I haven't had the time to go into complete detail, but I've probably, been more technical than I should have been already. So I think I'll just end here and, ask if there are questions.